leopard skin like a theme here?
Yeah, because leopard. I took these out of my own house.
You did?
Yeah, because I'm so like, touched
you
the
had
leopard
in your
freak.
House?
Yeah, I did.
Well, can we talk?
I kind of have the unusual decorating
taste. I like it.
Taste.
I actually like it.
They're comfortable.
Yeah, they're very comfortable.
Well, so can we talk about what did you repent for on Yom Kippur?
I repented for swell-headedness, arrogance, stiff-neckedness. That means I was stiff-necked. For impatience, for mostly for being impatient, for having lack of compassion. For my not my fellow man. I have a lot of compassion for the distant.
For the ones you don't know, yeah,
that's
absolutely.
Right. For the people I don't know, I really feel bad. But for those right next to me, shape up.
Damn it.
So I have a real, I have a little problem, you know, because
too.
You know, I have a very short tempered. Especially
too.
Lately, because everything is so, there's so much to do and so much to see and stuff get, you're just bombarded with stuff constantly and you just, you can't absorb it all. I feel like I'm the only person. See, I don't use the computer, so I don't know how.
I don't either. I don't even know how to turn one on.
I don't even know. I don't.
I think there's a devil.
Well, so do I. But don't tell anybody. My husband can turn it on. My husband uses it. My daughter uses it, but I can't use it. Yeah. I have my address book in it, but that's all I can do. I can just.
And like, do you ever get the feeling like if you turn it on, it's going to suck your entire soul out?
No. But I have gone, no, but I can
I
see where you would. I can see where you would because there's a lot going on in it.
And
it's
you
like
know what
it's
I
boiling.
Said, and it's like the only people on there, I don't care what they say, are sex perverts and people that can't get a patent. I swear.
I know exactly what you mean. I have gone into those chat rooms with my husband, and the level of discussion is unbelievably low. I mean, I'm talking low.
Like, I was thinking this about the presidency thing, the whole Clinton thing. They're trying to, like, moronize us.
Totally.
Just, like, concentrate on this sex act, so we'll look over there, because everybody's going to look.
You have a point. Go forward. Go for it. You think they're trying to moronize it.
Well,
yeah, they've been doing that for a
long time. They're really doing.
Exactly.
Right?
I'm sure a lot of people feel that way. A lot of people say, why are they taking away this president that we actually legitimately elected and are behind? Why are they doing that to us? You know, it's like OJ. It's as if they got done with OJ and then they looked around for someone else to nab. It really is like that. The fury, the frenzy surrounding OJ and the fact that everybody had the box on.
Well, yeah.
And they were selling newspapers and they were selling advertising because of OJ. Then OJ was done. It's like, who's next? Well, you know, it could be any of you. It could be any of you.
It could be
me. It would definitely be you, girl.
It definitely could be me.
It could be you.
I'm scared.
Because this whole privacy thing, if you take it a step further, you can see that all those barriers are falling, and there's no way once those barriers are down, those barriers are not going to come back up.
And once I said that, I was talking to Oprah about that a long time ago because it seemed like me and Oprah were like right in the vanguard of when they started to break down like all privacy issues.
Yeah.
And the people didn't realize that they weren't just reading it on the toilet magazine. It was going to happen to them, too. And it has.
Yeah.
It's happened everywhere.
Yeah.
It's scary.
I think, it is. It's terrifying. I mean, I don't know what the final outcome of it is because I can't absorb it all. I try to make some sense of it, and I read the papers, and I do watch the news. But to me, it's so overwhelming that it seems to be going so fast. And everyone, it's like the Tower of Babel. Everybody's yelling.
Right.
And there's
right.
no sense being made. And you remember Joe McCarthy? Remember Joe McCarthy in the
right.
50s? Remember that guy, Joe Welch, that said, he was a lawyer. He said, have you no decency? Haven't you had enough? He said to Joe McCarthy, who had ruined hundreds and hundreds of people's lives because he tainted them with communism. He said, have you no decency? Well, where's our Joe Welch? Where's the guy that's going to stand up and say to Ken Starr, okay, have you no decency? It's like you're sitting in the middle of the Spanish Inquisition.
It is the Spanish
Torquemada, you know?
Yeah, and you know what I think anyway is that he loved her. I think he loved her, and I know she says she loved him. You know why I know he loved her, and every day I'm more convinced of it?
Why?
Because he lost 40 pounds while he was going with her.
Aww.
Think about it.
Oh, I didn't even notice. I thought his bags have bags. I mean, he started out, he was he's a very nice-looking man, but
he is nice-looking.
As this is... His hair is gone totally white. Who could take that?
Nobody.
I have to say, for those two people, they were hounded from the minute they came into the door. They started and they didn't let up. They stood there for 6 years and got flings and arrows.
Why?
But the fact that they're still standing is like, oh my God. I mean, could you take it?
No.
You couldn't take it. I couldn't take it. I remember they wrote about me one time in the 80s in Jinx. They slandered me in Jinx. And I was so crushed. I was so ill from it that I had to lie down. I mean, I had a nervous breakdown. Can you imagine what these people are living
through
for 6 years?
Bet.
I can't believe it.
Bet.
I'm staggered by it.
Okay,
I'm
Bet.
Staggered.
Hey, honey.
Don't you... What's the matter with you? Wake up! Wake up! Oh.
I have to jump
They're
on that.
They're still standing.
No, but Bet.
What?
I have to go there for a minute because that was something that I always felt like totally connected to you on about Jinx, and I know you had like it was devastating to you.
But compared to what other people have lived through, it was nothing. It was like this.
It's nothing just because you've already lived through it. But when you were living through it, it wasn't nothing.
No, it felt like the planet was caving in. But it was a teeny weeny thing, really.
But you know, it totally changed everything you did after that. It totally changed your life.
I went into a shell. I became like a turtle. I just pulled my head in.
And I
was horrified.
I read stuff you said after you go. I've learned I can't care as much as I did.
I can't. I couldn't be as outrageous. I couldn't be as insane because I could see where it was going to lead. I mean, if you put yourself out, look what happened to you.
I mean,
how did you live through that?
I don't know. I don't know how I lived through it. I think because I had kids.
That helps. Yeah. That helps a whole lot.
But how'd you live through yours? You didn't even have any kids.
No, I didn't have any kids at the time, but I got one. I went out like, I better get somebody, you know, I mean, because you can't be on your own in this
kind
of...
But it did, like, the total spiritually change you on every level.
Completely. And it was truly, it was in the big picture, it was nothing. So, but I know what I felt. And when I look at what they have, the abuse that the Clintons have taken... to me, the fact that they're still standing, that they're still behaving with any shards of dignity left to them, clinging to their person, is to me just, it's monumental.
Are you seeing Bette Midler's story in there a little bit?
No, I really don't. I feel that it's been a runaway train. I mean, it's gathered speed and momentum, and that no one has the nerve to tell. I feel like I should get. I feel like
well,
I should
you
get.
You told
I should
them.
Get like the card, and I should stand in front of the Capitol building by myself. Does anyone want to come? You know, I mean, I feel like I have to do something, but I don't know how to get on the internet. I don't know how to email anybody. You know, I'd be like, oh, I'll email someone.
Okay,
but I don't know how.
More with Bette when we come back after this commercial.
Yes, I did. She's fabulous. She's great.
You're such a great actor.
I am.
Yes, because the emotion that we feel when we watch you, we cry and we laugh. And I think that you're like the only one that can do both of those things.
Oh, that's so kind of you.
You're
the
only one.
Thank you. I'm the only one.
You're the best at it.
Thank you.
You're the best.
That's my gift.
I was going to talk about it is your gift.
That's my gift. I don't have many gifts. I have small feet.
That's a gift.
I have nice feet. I have very nice wrists and hands. Very pretty feet, but my gift was that I could make people laugh and make people cry right away.
Did you always know you could do it?
No, I never did. No, I didn't know. It took me about. I think I was about when I first started singing. I used to see them cry, and then that's when I.
Me too.
And then I realized I had said there was something there. But
how
I always
old
used to
were
make,
you when
make
that,
them laugh too. I was older. I was about 24, 25. When I started singing, I was in my mid-20s.
You didn't sing when you were a little girl?
I sang I sang around the house, and I sang for the school. I won talent contests. I won a talent contest singing the lullaby of Broadway, and so that became like my signature tune. But then one day I was walking down the in the school, and I heard two girls talking about the upcoming talent contest, and they said, is she going to sing that song again? And I thought, oh, well, I can't sing that again. It was the only song I had, so.
But
it's painful.
Did you know, like inside yourself, did you hear voices or bells or whistles or anything that said that you had been given this gift when you were little that kind of helped you get
well,
through?
Well, I knew I had a really loud voice. I knew it was loud. I didn't think it was good, but I knew it was loud. Because I used to sing in the shower and people used to gather downstairs. Outside I lived on a two-story apartment and people used to stand on the lawn and listen to me sing. So I knew that I could, it was loud. I knew I was reaching them down there on the grass.
Did you never get the feeling that you were channeling something that was given from above?
Never.
Until you were older, because you have to have that now, right?
Totally. Now I do. Now I realize that everybody doesn't sing. I wish everybody would sing. If everybody would sing or play an instrument, then we wouldn't have any war.
That's true.
And people would be a lot happier, because music really does make you happy. It makes you full of joy.
It
lifts us, absolutely. That's a gift from God. I really do believe that.
You didn't have that
I took
when
it
you
for
were
granted.
Little.
I took it for granted, because I always did it. I opened my mouth and the music came out. So I always took it for granted. The one thing I didn't take for granted that I thought I would be, I really thought I would be a great actor. I thought I would be Ethel Barrymore. I mean, I didn't even know Ethel Barrymore. I never saw her work, but I read about her. You know, I used to read about Ethel Barrymore in books. And I said, I'm going to be that, even though I had no idea what it was. And so I would, I tried to go onto the stage, and I couldn't get jobs. I got a job in Fiddler on the Roof where I stayed for 3 years, and I could not get another job.
Why?
I don't know. Too short, too tall, too blue, too green, too red, too small. I mean, I couldn't get a job. I was always the wrong type. So I turned to singing because I had no other choice. I said, well, there's got to be a way.
So your first thing is acting.
My first thing was
acting. And you turned to singing, and you just happen to have, like, the greatest voice in the world.
It's not the greatest voice in the world. It's a good voice.
It's the most humane and giving and emotional voice there is.
I love you so much!
I love you. Aww. You're so great.
Thank you!
Stay with us. We'll be right back. I wanted to ask about your dysfunctional family because I wanted to ask, like, your
family
father
is not dysfunctional.
Okay, why don't you think it's dysfunctional?
I'll tell you why. Because I never really did drugs. I never really did alcohol. I supported myself. I put a roof over my head and clothes on my back. I believed in work. I learned how to work. I learned discipline. I learned to love the world. I learned to love human beings. I learned what was right and what was wrong. I think they really did a good job. I think my family's fabulous. I mean, they were a little loony. They were a little loony. But
Let me tell you what I read.
I'm perfect.
Didn't your dad, like, he wasn't all that...
he was not encouraging.
He didn't encourage you at all.
He was not encouraging, but now I think it was a ploy.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, I think it was it was like a scheme he had to make me really get going.
To get, like, really dig in.
Yeah,
and,
He was never supportive. He was never supportive.
Maybe, you know, that's like a Jewish thing, though.
Totally
act like, oh, you don't know what you're doing.
Fair.
Yeah, so you'll get stronger
that's
and stronger.
Right.
Are you
that's
like right. a typical Jewish mother?
No, I'm not.
You're not?
No, I never say fair. I never say that. I never say that you're not good. I always say, you know what? You could do better. Or it's fabulous, but I never say you're no good. The one thing I can never believe that a parent would turn to a kid and say, "You're nothing. You'll never amount to a row of pins." How can you say that to a kid? It's the cruelest thing in the whole world.
Because, you know, that person's in obviously a lot of pain and lost and messed up.
Which
themselves.
One? Oh, you mean the person that's
the
screaming.
Parent? Yeah.
Yeah, but then they inflict that on the kid.
And then the kid does it to their kid.
That's right. It's a vicious circle. I hate it. I hate it.
But you don't even use guilt on your daughter or anything
well,
like
yes,
that?
Well, yes, I do a little bit of that.
See, I knew you were, because I do that. I'm so good at that.
Are you good at that?
Yeah.
They nail me, though. They don't let me get away with it.
Why? How do they catch
because
you?
I walk out. I'm a walker outer.
Oh, I am.
You know the kind that's when you don't get your way, you just walk out. You stop speaking, you walk out.
Right.
That's what I do. And they know now. So they don't even bother to come after me. Yeah, let her go. You know, they don't even bother. They say, you're doing it again, and then I have to, all right, You nailed
That's cool to get called on your stuff.
Fine. It's fine.
And you're very happy. You've been married for like a longer than anybody in Hollywood. Is it so great.
It's so. How long have you been married?
This time? I'm into my fourth year, which is pretty awesome.
That's fantastic
for
you.
It's good for me, yeah. I'm learning a lot.
Yeah. Great.
What's your big thing you learned from being married?
Well, I'm trying to learn patience, but I'm not having much luck. That's why I had to go and pray. Please give me some patience. What's the big thing that I learned? I learned you have to give up a lot.
Yeah.
And you have to give it up with a nice face on. You can't give it up and be sour about it. You have to give it up and say, okay, and be nice. You can't be nasty about it.
I learned that that compromise doesn't mean you're going to get murdered.
That's a good one.
Yeah. That was a big one for me.
You mean for you to compromise?
For me to always before, I guess because I was in such a victim mode, you know, I was always like, every day was a war that I might lose my life in. That's how I was raised, and it always carried over, and I never looked at it.
Really?
Till I finally went, wait a minute, this isn't a war anymore. The war is over. You won, you lived, and, you know, you don't have to repeat it every single day. You don't have to go to the nth degree of every small thing.
Yes, every little thing. You don't have to win every...
But
pick your battles.
I think that's so Jewish. I think it's a Jewish woman thing.
What do you mean?
Because we just have to fight for so long and always and so hard.
Oh,
and
well, you make it sound like we're warrior women.
We are.
I don't think so.
You don't think we're warrior
women? No, I just think
we're
just, you know, just... cranky. Just like, I want it my way, you know, that type of thing. I think we're just stubborn. Stubborn.
I think we're warriors.
Well, God bless you, girl.
Yeah, because, you know, I look at my grandma and all those women from Russia. Oh, my God.
Yeah. Well, I think that my mother had a lot of that. Yeah. But I don't think of myself as particularly... I'm too busy to think of myself as a warrior.
But you are, though, because you go up in the face of every single thing, and you know you do, and I know you do it so nice. I'm like in awe of, like, look at her. Look how she does it.
She hates that I'm nice.
No,
I
love it.
Nice.
No, I love it, and
you
I've
do?
Learned a lot watching it, because I'm like, she's not confrontational.
Well, I used to be really rude, and people told me when I was very young, you know what, that's not how to behave. You know, old-timers would come to me and say, you know, you better watch your mouth. You can get into a lot of trouble like that. And I listened. I listened because I could see which way it could go.
Right.
You know, you're at the fork in the road. You can either go that way or you can go that way. And I chose to go the way the old timers suggested to me that I go.
Yeah.
And I'm still here, which says a lot. You know, sometimes that old timers advice is really good advice.
I'd love to hear you sing that great song. And
you
I'm
would?
Still here. You know that great song? But now you can't be a diva and not sing. So when we come back, Miss Midler is going to belt one out for us.
You're still chewing. You're still eating hot tamales.
I thought I'd be done by now. I'll swallow. Welcome back, Bette. Oh, you know, you have had an awesome life. You've lived in a lot of really cool places, and you've done a lot of amazing things.
Thank you very much.
Now, I'm tired of talking about them. I think it's time we go visit them.
Let's talk about you for a change.
Now, we're going to go visit these places. Come on Roseanne's Magic Carpet Ride. I got to cover my knee highs. Here we are. Oh, you look fetching. You look way more glamorous. I got to get more glamorous.
Really, girl?
Yeah, you look good there.
Try pants next time.
I should have thought of that. Anyway.
And real high heels.
Here we are.
Oh, it's
We're going on a slight tour of some of the places Miss Bette Midler used to live and frequent. Starting with Aiea Elementary School
still
in
there?
Hawaii.
I thought they tore it down.
Check it out.
Oh, yes. Oh, look at that sky, the greatest sky in the world.
You were in sixth grade, and that's where you entered your first talent contest and won how much?
$2.
That's where you sang Lullaby of
Broadway. That was right. That was one of the watermarks of my life.
It's a beautiful, beautiful place.
It's a
place.
Gorgeous place. Look at that. I'm telling you, that sky was so magnificent. The clouds, when the rain came. You know, the Hawaiians have 500 names for rain.
Really?
Yeah. They have the soft rain, the gentle rain, the rain that comes on the east wind, the rain that comes on the west. Oh, it's fabulous.
It's a beautiful place. Fabulous people, too. Let's fly on. Here's the pineapple factory in Honolulu. Hold on, honey, hold on.
Oh my God, not the pineapple factory. Turn this thing around.
And you worked there, right?
I did.
There's a pineapple.
That's still standing. That's a landmark. That was for Dole. That was a very upmarket pineapple cannery. I worked the downmarket pineapple cannery.
What was that like? That was the assembly line?
Total assembly line. See, that's me back there.
Oh, my God. 3 summers during high school.
Yeah.
Did you have to slice them?
From the time I was 13 years old to the time I was 16 years old. So every summer.
That's kind of
something. And you got like $30 a week. Thrilling. It was so thrilling.
What'd you do? Did you slice them
or peel
them?
I took the bad bits off. The two ends are not good.
No,
the back end and the front end are not good. So you tip that off, and then you just take the really good slices from the middle and put them in a can.
Aww.
Oh, I was so good.
You know,
glad.
I love pineapple. Thank you.
You're so
Let's
welcome.
Let's fly on. Let's go to New York City, the Improv, 1969, where Bud Friedman becomes Bette's first manager. There it is.
It should only have looked that good. It never looked that good.
I don't think it even exists anymore. This
No,
is an old
they
picture.
Shut it down. We had some fun. It's so much fun.
Now, could you have found a
Annie
weirder
Kaufman
guy?
Annie Kaufman was there. Richie Pryor was there. Everybody was there. It was great fun.
Did you know Andy Kaufman at all?
I did. I knew him slightly.
What a great
He was fabulous. But Richie Pryor, can we talk?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my
Brilliant.
God.
Oh, my God. Brilliant.
That was a long time ago.
Now, in New York, that's where you went to the gay bathhouse, the Continental Bath.
That's right.
In the basement of the
Ansonia Hotel.
And this is where
Sanford White Building, a landmark building in New York City where all the opera teachers are now.
And where you really started didn't you?
I was liberated there, yes I was.
And tell who your piano player was.
Barry Manilow.
How awesome is that?
But first my first piano player was Billy Cunningham. I lost track of him. But I saw Barry Manilow last night.
It's so great that both of you went on and like Harlettes, you had Melissa Manchester, right? She was one of the Harlettes.
Katie Sagal was one too.
Katie Sagal sings so great.
Isn't she great?
She's a great
she was a great Harlette. She was a fabulous Harlette.
And now we're going to Las Vegas where Bette had her candlelight wedding chapel, where an Elvis impersonator marries Bette and Martin Van Hasselberg
at
1984.
That's right. That's exactly
you
right.
You swear to God had an Elvis impersonator marry you?
Yes, we had an Elvis impersonator marry us. And it lasted.
And it's lasted how many years?
We've been married almost 14 years.
Next time I get married, perhaps I'll try the Elvis impersonator.
It worked for me.
Air traffic control is going to find us a runway. And when we come back, more with Bette. Now you've got me going like this, too. To go back to the bathhouse years, because it's just so fascinating. Because you know that's where I first saw you on Johnny Carson and everything.
Yeah.
But I thought it was so cool how you and Barry Manilow, who like went on to become so huge. There you are, like. And you still get along, right?
Yeah, I saw him last night. In fact, he took me to the Society of Singers dinner for Rosemary Clooney, who I really, really love.
Did somebody call?
Oh my God! For God's sake.
How are you? Hi. Welcome, Yoshi.
Thank you.
Oh, honey.
Really, I was just passing by.
Thank you, darling. Oh, no, 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 no. Is so evil.
Yes?
I'm going to introduce them all.
Charlo Crossley.
You introduce them.
Linda Hart. Jenifer Lewis from St. Louis. Melissa Manchester. I can't believe this. This is so fabulous. You are a stinker.
Nobody called me. Yes, hello.
Hello, darling.
Hello, darling girl.
Hi. How are you?
Hello, Charlo Crossley. How are the family?
Katie Sagal.
How's your mother father?
We're
getting that tonight.
No, I didn't say she was the best. I said she sang well. I didn't say she was the best.
Oh my God, this is so
That's
fabulous. We all love you.
How wonderful of you all. Barry, what am I going to sing?
I'm all alone. Go on.
And I am all alone. Oh, God. I used to sit just like this. There is no one here beside me.
God, the memories.
Oh, it's too much. And my problems have all gone. There is no one to deride me. You're a stinker. But you got to have friends. The feelings are so strong. You got to have friends to make that day last long. I had some friends, but they're gone. Something came and took them away. And from the dusk till the dawn, here is where I'll stay. Standing at the end of the road, boys, waiting for my new friends to come. I don't care if I'm hungry or cold. I'm gonna get me some, because you got to have friends. From the dust till the dawn, here is where I'll stay. Now what happens? Bop, 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 bop. I don't care if I'm hungry or freezing, it's cold. I got to get me, whoa, whoa.
The Harlettes for a minute. Each and every one of you must have some simply divine story to share with us about the divine Miss M. Melissa Manchester.
Yes, well, this is a story about the sweeter, more maternal side of the more postpartum kind of Bette, the kind that not many people get the phone call from, and Bette and I had babies at around the same time. Thank you, Barry. And she called me one day, and we were just checking up on each other, and you don't remember this, and you said, are you crying a lot? Because our babies were about 5 minutes old. She said, are you crying a lot? Because I'm just crying all the time. And I said, well, yes, honey, and I cry and I sing to the baby. And she says, well, what are you singing? And I said, well, I find myself singing strange songs, like I'm singing Let Me Call You Sweetheart, I'm in Love with You. I said, why? What are you singing? She said, old union songs.
Now that's funny. That's
kind of frightening in a way.
Do you have a good story?
Jennifer Lewis. I have to say my name. Jennifer Lewis.
Wait a minute, Bette, you have to say it. Jennifer Lewis from where?
St. Louis.
There you go.
Hi.
Now, we're in Denver. We're in the middle of Pretty Legs and Great Big Knockers. And Bette, it's like 140 in the shade. Bette goes outside to the wings, falls out. Because it's so hot. I mean, literally, falls out. They've got her under a mask, an oxygen mask. So Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy of Company B, her big hit, starts to play.
The trumpet is computerized, so they can't stop the show. She's not on stage. We're looking to the left, we're looking to the right. No bet. So it's doom, 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 doom. We look to the left, we look to the right. No bet, Midler, I say forget it. Doom, 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 doom. He was a famous trumpet man. So it gets back that I literally stepped over her body to take over the song, and it was a bloody life.
Do you have a story,
Linda
too?
Hart, ladies and
Linda
gentlemen.
Linda Hart, darling, thank you. We had the same dressing room tonight, and we survived, okay? The best story, and there are so many, but my grandmother, who was 90 years old at the time when she met Bette, and she was so fond of Bette, and we were in Detroit, Michigan, and we're on our way to Broadway, and it's kind of like a relief. We're off the road, we're going to Broadway, and it's the audience will not go home. She's already in the dressing room. She's taken off her clothes. So she grabs this white towel, and she walks on stage, and they're going insane. And she's standing there in the towel, and she sings this, or says this beautiful little poem. And then there's that moment where Art Woods on the drum goes into boom, 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 boom. And I see Bette go, no, no, don't do that, because, you know, something divine comes over her at these moments. And it was just the tiny little bit of a flash. And now the show is over, and it's great, and the show is over. Now, my grandmother, who I actually, the paramedics came up to her because she was in the third row, and she had just gone down like this. So she came backstage, and I said, Grandmother, did you like the show? She's from Texas. And she said, well, hon, she's got a pretty good act, but she really doesn't need that towel number. She said it just doesn't go very far.
Do you have a story?
Just for the archival people out there and all the historians, I replaced Melissa Manchester. So I was the first replacement in the Harlettes, and I got a chance to work with Barry. And the greatest thing, it's not real, you know, provocative, although I have provocative stories I could share, but I won't, was that rehearsing and learning the music was just so great. And just to learn those songs off that first album, when Melissa taught me everything, all the songs, and sitting with Barry in his apartment on 29th Street and being at your house downtown in the Village was really fun. And that's, it's like family when you have 30 years with someone.
She doesn't want you to say 30 years, but it has
or
been 50, 30 years.
Or 60 years.
I think we're 29.
We are. No, we have like 60 years. It's fun. Thank you.
This is another maternal Bette story, but it's about you being maternal toward me. When I had some surgery in 1973. And, you know, we needed the work, you know, and we had this tour that was going to take place for 4 or 5 days. And I figured if I can't go, the girls won't make any money. So Bette said, I'll take care of you. We'll room together and I'll make sure you're okay. So we stayed in the same room for one night. She made the room so hot to try to save, you know, keep me healthy, that I moved out immediately.
It was a scene. It was a real scene.
It was great.
I'll never forgive you for this.
I just was like trying to see if I could be really tricky and not give it away.
You were really.
Because any minute I just want to go, guess what? Yeah. I restricted.
Restrained.
Yes.
Yes, very good. Excellent. Excellent acting. I'll remember this when it comes time to one of those big Hollywood parts. You're going to be the first one to get one.
Oh, get me one with music in it,
won't
you?
Of course. Of course I will. But them first.
Okay, them before me.
You're so welcome.
I'd like to thank all my guests today. Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching, and thank you here for coming to see our show. We'll see you later. Bye-bye.
Coming up next week on Good Morning Texas, Neil Diamond, Delta Burke, Annie Potts, and Gary Morris. That's next week at 9 on Good Morning Texas.